let's look a bit at Abraham. You know, Abraham was a spirit realm person, and he had that history before he met God. As a matter of fact, it was within the context of his spiritual engagement that God met him. Now, the name Abraham, generally we are told that the name Abram, before it was changed to Abraham, means exalted father. But really, that's not what it means. It's deeper than that. You know, I had an experience sometimes back when the Lord took me back in time, in this case, to engage a number of things, for example, about Abraham. Now, the name Abram, actually meant high father or high priest. Abraham, at the time, was the serving high priest for his family. Now, it was during his interactions, you know, services and, you know, spiritual services on behalf of his family and the deity, the family worshipped, that questions that bothered around reality for what is true, the true God, began to come into his heart. Now, those questions he was beginning to ask was what opened the door for God to come through and talk to Abraham. Now, that was the reason why when he eventually received the instruction to leave, the father moved with him. It wasn't because the father loved him than the rest. It was Abraham was the serving high priest. And it wasn't because it was his father's favorite. It was the serving high priest. That's where he got the name Abram. Abram from. Now, number two, it was that service he was rendering for the family was what informed the choice of the woman he married, Sarah. And one of the things we'll see is that Sarah, one of the consequences, all right, now, for serving in that capacity, you know, and, you know, having that level of closer interaction with that deity was barrenness. Now, Sarah's barrenness wasn't just, it wasn't coincidental. Because if you also look at, if you look at their son, Isaac, the wife, Rebecca, for a while too, she had issues with barrenness. Not until Isaac prayed, you know, she became pregnant. Now, if you look at, now I'm trying to show you the history of that from that region. Now, if you look at, what's her name? Rachel as well. Rachel too became unusually barren. But if you look closely, you will see that it was not the problem wasn't far away from the affiliation to the idol. Rachel had a strong, you know, affiliation for the idol her father served, worshipped. Now, the reason why her father was actually refusing Jacob from getting married to Rachel first, it wasn't because in their culture the younger doesn't get married before the eldest. That's not true. Now, because of, you know, the commitment, the loyalty that, you know, Rachel had been showing towards that deity, the father was already planning, was already arranging for her, you know, to take over as the next, you know, priest or priestess for the family. Now, see what happened. When they were told they were going to leave, she carried the idol, sat on them. It's not because she, it was because of that. Now, when you connect it to Rebecca, you see the same thing. Now, the way Rebecca was able to influence Jacob to you know, deceive the father into receiving the blessing, that was not of God. That was sorcery. That was sorcery. Now, this is, like I said, they're not in black and white. Now, it took me a while to accept some of these things until I began to ask questions that The answer is already in scriptures. For example, if we go back to Abraham, why did his father follow him? It wasn't because of love. Then the Lord led me to look at that word again, Abraham. Now, generally, we are told, King James tells us that it means exalted father. In what context? Number two, God didn't just show up to Abraham. Abraham was seeking for reality. He didn't know God. God had to introduce himself. Is that not what God told Moses? He said, Abraham didn't. He said, just by my name, by myself, Almighty, I revealed myself to Abraham. Abraham didn't know God. God had to, you know, break out to him. Now, what I'm trying to say is this. Eventually, when Abraham began his walk with God, Abraham, of course, began another walk in the realm of the kingdom of light. He began to walk with God. But the background training he had from, you know, spiritism in the realm of darkness, number one, gave him a foundation of, you know, discipline. That was what informed the discipline with which he walked with God. Now, some of his understanding of the spiritual realm helped. Look at when God, for example, told him to, when God was going to give him an assurance, or when God was going to speak to him about him, what was going to befall his descendant. Look at what God told him, when God told him to get to get a turtle dove, to get, now see the age, see, he said a 3-year calf, 3-year. God didn't explain, the guy knew, this guy, and see, the Bible says that God told him, and do you notice how he caught them in between? The Bible said that he caught the calf in between, into two, he caught the other one into two, caught the turtle into, he said, but the turtle dove and the pigeon, he didn't cut. Now, the Bible now said that he now set each piece against each other. You know what Abraham did? God wanted to talk to Abraham. But God, you know, gave Abraham the instruction of getting these particular animals because he wanted to, Abraham was still learning, he wanted to come through for Abraham. Now, if you look at that scripture very well, the way Abraham arranged these animals was to create a portal. The Bible said that he created each piece against each other. The first animal was set against each other. The second, the third, then the dove. Now, I wish I could draw that. Eventually, what was formed is similar to, you know, a V or a Y. A V or Y. Now, where did God tell him to do that? And you see, when God told him that, God didn't tell him how to do it. This man understood. Now, what I'm trying to say, you know, thank you so much, sir. You know, are you open to that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Right,
okay, can you read it, ma?
And he said unto him, take me an heifer of 3 years old, mm-hmm. and a she-goat of 3 years old.
Okay.
And a ram of 3 years old.
Okay.
And a turtle dove.
Three of them. Now, the turtle dove and the pigeon. Now, can you read how he, you know, split the
and
two?
And he took unto him all these and divided them in the midst.
Okay. Divided them in the midst.
In the midst. And
that means he tore them up. You know.
Open.
Yes. But the way he arranged them became something like this. So the heifer, the two piece, he arranged like this side by side against each other. The second one, now.
And then he. The heifer, after the heifer is a goat,
mm-hmm.
and then after the goat is a ram.
The ram. This is how Abraham arranged them.
Then the turtle dove.
He didn't cut.
He didn't cut the turtle dove.
And the pigeon. So what did he do? He put them like this. This is what you have. Now, I want you to read the following verse, man. When God eventually came, he said,
when
the evening
was sun was going down, mm-hmm. deep sleep fell upon Abraham.
Okay.
And lo, an horror of great darkness fell upon him.
Mm-hmm.
And he said unto Abraham, know of a surety that your seed shall be a stranger in a land.
Now, hold on, my first. He says, a horror of what?
great darkness.
Okay. There's something I'm looking for. Sorry.
Fell upon him.
Okay, just read on now.
Mm-hmm. And he said unto Abraham, know of a sure that thy seed shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs, and shall serve them, and they shall afflict. No, don't worry. It's in verse 17. What you're looking for is probably in verse 17. And it came to pass that when the sun went down, and it was dark, behold, a smoking furnace and a burning lamp that passed between those pieces.
Do you see? Passed between the pieces. What Abraham used this to do was to create a portal. But what I'm going to say is, look at his knowledge. How did he know? Of course, he had a history of being a spiritual man, but in the realm of darkness. But the Lord took advantage, as it were, of his knowledge of basic spirit training principle. Now, for that kind of a man, God didn't have to teach him how to create a portal. He knew what portals are. Now, it's the same thing. I've met people who now, if you sit down with an occult man and talk to him about portal, I remember reading a story that this man told Smith Wigglesworth. He said he was teaching in a place, and this witch man that was in the meeting understood what he was saying. But of course, what he couldn't understand is the access. He couldn't gain access. But he had a basic understanding. Because he was operating the spirit realm, but in the realm of darkness. Now, if you talk to an occult person about portal, they know what it is. If you talk to a witch about a portal, they know what it is. For example, how do witches enter or go have a meeting in a tree? We hear those stories. They tell you they're having a meeting in a tree. The fact is this. Witches don't hold meetings in a tree. What they use the tree for, they use the tree as a portal through which they go into the spirit realm. But because people don't know, people who are under ignorance, they'll tell you that tree, that's where they're having. They can't have the meeting in the tree. They enter the spirit realm through the tree. What?
Harry Potter? I've seen something like
the I've not watched Harry Potter, but I think I know the woman who So, but you see, but people are like, that's where the now you, we've had where, you know, cases where evangelists or missionaries have gone to villages to try to even cut down a tree. And they cut down the tree, and it is either maybe nothing happened, or is that maybe nothing happened, or they cut down the tree and that didn't stop witchcraft. The mistake the evangelists were making is that they thought the tree was the problem. The tree was just a doorway. Or you see, if evangelists will go to places and they will surround the tree and begin to pray. They are binding the tree. And the witches are laughing. Like, these guys are ignorant. The tree is just a, you know, an entry point. So, now, what I'm trying to, you know, what I want to say is this. I want to connect something. By the time Abraham began to, because he made reference to Abraham and Abraham's success in business. Now, Abraham prospered in business, of course, by reason of God's blessing, but also in connection to his understanding of the spiritual. Take, for example, I love that scripture so much, when Abraham needed to get a wife for Isaac. Now, see the confidence with which he expressed, all right, the certainty that the woman cannot become, whether the woman that, you know, the certainty with which, you know, he spoke to Eliezer, that don't worry, you get a wife. Now, when Eliezer wanted to express, you know, doubt, Eliezer began to say, what if the woman does not come? What if the woman does not follow me? The Bible says the first thing Abraham did to shut that down was to, first of all, describe the history of his walk with God, upon which he now said, that God that I walked with, that I left all and have come this far with, he said, he shall send his angels. Now, one of the, you know, mindset many believers have about the blessings of God is that you are just walking with God and things are just good. No. The blessings of God, of course, does that. But there is a height of the operation of God's blessings that would require a level of understanding, operation, I mean participation from your own end. There are certain involvement of angels in our lives that their ministry in our lives will not be thorough, will not be, you know, 100% if we are not, you know, if we do not understand how to work with them, you know, by way of them, you know, functioning, you know, participating. You know, there are some angels that whose ministry will not be, you know, fully expressed if we do not see them, or if we are not aware of their presence, you know, to be able to acknowledge them. There are some angels that just by, you know, the basic faith understanding of, you know, speaking the word of God, they'll be released. But there are some angels that will require that you see them, you hear what they have to say for their ministry to be complete. That is one of the reasons why when we look at the patriarchs of faith, we call them our fathers of faith, but we don't want to have the discipline. They had in spirit work. Look at Job. Job was a spirit guy. Job walked in the spirit. Look at Abraham. Abraham walked in the spirit. Abraham could tell Eliezer that he shall send his angel. Abraham wasn't just talking to somebody who talked faith. He wasn't just talking faith. Abraham understood faith. For them, they knew faith to be spirit realm participation. Their understanding of faith was operating spirit realm. It's not just, you know, today we think faith is just talk the word. That's why I usually say, what is the word of God? The word of God is not just talk. The word of God is spirit. Now, we have a division today. There's been this issue. We have a division today. Broken people say that we are word people. We are spirit people. That's nonsense. There is no such thing. Now, some people have bought into that twist. They've gone and have written books saying things like there's a need for the remarriage of the word and the spirit. The question is, what is the word? The word is not just... You know, so you have people who say things like they tell themselves they claim that they are what people because they teach. Then they say those who are people are those who are more into miracles, and it's all nonsense. The word is spirit.
That's right.
And there is no walking in the word or walking with the word
that
will not produce spirit encounter, spirit experience. This doesn't exist.
That's right.
What we've just come to have is people who have gone, you know, two extremes.
Mm.
You know, they've stayed with the revelatory, as it were, the revelatory expression of the word, while some others have gone into the ditch of the experiential, you know, the demonstrative expression of the spirit. But it's the same. So this was the kind of understanding that men like Abraham, you know, had. That was why Abraham was able to have the kind of success he had. It was the blessing. But the understanding of the blessing is the release of God's favor that brings you into, you know, very powerful spiritual engagement. What I meant is their understanding of the blessing was that they were to function, a certain responsibility of operating, or a certain understanding of participation in the spiritual came with the blessing. The blessing didn't make them passive people. Their understanding of the blessing didn't, you know, it's not that of, you know, being passive. You know, that's the understanding we have today when we talk about Abraham's blessings. Is ours. Is this passive, you know, just wake up, everything is okay, you know. No, it's not always like that.
That's right.
The blessing comes with the resource of the kingdom that you are responsible to engage with, to interact with.
That's right.
So when God releases a blessing, now there are some, for example, there is no, the release of the blessing of God will have, you can't help it. It will have activate a measure of the angelic realm. There are different operations of God within the blessing that different ages have a responsibility of stewarding. You know, of stewarding. So a whole lot of times, not being able to interact with the forces of the kingdom that are released with the released blessing, a whole lot of time causes, you know, things just, you know, the fullness of what should, you know, we should enter into, you know, let's say within 2 years, takes 10 years. Now, because it takes 10 years, we'll now begin to think that's God's time. That's God's time. You know, so you see these things in scriptures. So Abraham was a spirit realm person. He was okay. Look at his descendant, his children. Look at his grandson Jacob. He struck a deal with Laban. Laban laughed because Laban was far older than Jacob. He was his uncle. Laban knew that in all of his experience, that deal is not possible. But he took an angel appearing to Jacob in a dream and gave him instructions which he carried out when he woke up. He had to see that angel to receive that instruction. And see how a biological law was shattered. Biologically, that's not possible. But a lot of times, you know, one of the problems we have is that we think we have a misunderstanding about the New Testament. We have a misunderstanding about the grace. So we think grace just means, or we think rest just means, you know, you're just there. You become redundant. God is doing everything. No. What grace, you know, means, or in this context now, is that you have, on account of Jesus's, you know, death and resurrection, the New Testament saint has a higher level of operation.
That's right.
Of course, with a higher level of operation comes a higher level of participation. Responsibility. You should. In fact, if it took them so much to be able to have the kind of breakthroughs they had into spirit realm, for example, having to do with their sight, it means on account of grace, sin should be with ease. Mm-hmm. So grace does not, nonetheless, excuse you from sin. You have to see. Mm-hmm. So there are some, see, there's an expression of the blessings of God that many people have written for them in the scrolls of their testimony that they haven't been able to enter because they haven't been able to come up to a level of increased responsibility and participation in the spirit. It's not because that thing is reserved for the future. It's not because, you know, I don't know if you know what I'm trying to say. You know, so, that's a lot of people. You have a lot of people. You have a lot of people that are just, men of God are just, you know, but the New Testament opens the church, opens the saint, opens a believer to a broader, you know, limitless, you know, outpour, you know, availability of the kingdom of God, which means that to be able to harness unless all that is available to us in Christ, we must be very functional people, must be practical people. We must be very practical people. You know, so, over the work of your hand, there is an angel that has a number of angels under his oversight. Now, the various angels that work with this angel have peculiar responsibility of unlocking the various layers within the blessing that is contained in the scroll of the testimony of your family heritage, your family call. You know, there is a call over your family that is contained in the testimony of the witnesses or prophecy of Jesus Christ before God. And there is an angel that has on him a number of angels that is given the responsibility of stewarding That's blessing. I said that the other angels that work with this angel have peculiar, you know, different responsibilities, specific responsibilities of activating the various expressions of God within that blessing. Now, are these things real? Yes, scripturally, look at this. Abraham spoke about a particular angel. There was an angel that appeared to him from the clouds that spoke God's blessing over him when he was about to kill, or after he didn't, you know, lay his hand on him, on Isaac. Now, his son enjoyed the benefit of that. Now, look at Jacob. Jacob met with an angel. He met with an angel who came to confront a perverted or twisted, you know, deceptive state of the heart. Now, the warfare that angel, you know, brought into Jacob's life, it was not a physical. That warfare wasn't physical. Now, most times in the church, we've come to say it wasn't physical. The angel wasn't warring with Jacob bodily. It was a war, or it was a contention to address the state of Jacob's heart. So the basis for the warfare was Jacob's, you know, attempt to hold on to that state of heart. Why the angel was, you know, he brought John into that state of heart. Because if the warfare was bodily, how come the angel, is it that the angel just suddenly realized that he could dislocate his thigh? He could have done that all along. So what the angel, what the angel was saying, what the scripture, you know, says when he says that, the angel said, let me go. It was not that Jacob was holding, no. It was that the angel had an assignment to judge the state of his heart. That was the basis of the wrestle. It was not a wrestle with Jacob. It was a wrestle, all right, resulting from Jacob's attempt to retain a state of heart that angel was assigned to judge. Now, eventually, after that, we know the story. Now, look at when Jacob, by the time he was old, was going to bless Ephraim and Manasseh. You remember the mention he made of a particular angel. He said, the angel that preserved me, that redeemed me from evil and preserved me all these years. The angel. He didn't say angels. He knew the angel. And he mentioned that angel while he was blessing Ephraim and Manasseh. Now, so, in as far as destinies are concerned, they are usually they are angels that are released to steward, you know, destinies over the lives of people. Now, it's funny, this kind of thing is not common, and now these things are coming as some people are quarreling with the ministers who are sharing it. They are saying this is one of the reasons many people have found it difficult to enter into their destinies. It's not because they are not praying enough. Okay, let me use a popular contemporary example. You know, I think I've mentioned this before. Kenneth Hagin, all right, when he was having a meeting, I think I mentioned you know the story. He was having a meeting, you know, in between the meeting, he had to go and rest before the next session. He was in the sleeping area of the trailer house when he was hearing them, you know, footsteps in the sitting area. You know, he just kept ignoring because he was tired. Eventually, he eventually told himself, okay, let me go check what's there. As he was getting there, the angel was taking off. At that point, he began to pray, the angel was gone. He said it was not until a year after Jesus appeared to him. Then he was having a praying time, you know, about, you know, new direction for ministry. Jesus appeared, a year after Jesus appeared, and began to say things to him. Then he said each time, while Jesus was speaking, each time he takes his gaze off Jesus and look at the angel will want to begin to say something. So he would take his gaze off and fix it back on Jesus. Then after Jesus was going out, the Lord said, what does this angel want to say? The Lord has said, listen to him. He has a message for you. Like, Lord, but you are here. Give it to me. He said, no, he's your angel. He has a message. And because he's your angel, he has the responsibility of the world, of delivering the message. Now, long story short, the angel delivered the message. The message the angel delivered was a message the angel was sent. The angel told him that it was the angel that was sent a year before. Now, as soon as the angel, now the message the angel delivered had to do with, you know, finances, new supply, new resource for ministry, which he began to enjoy after that visitation that he that ought to have started, he ought to have started experiencing a year before. Now, between that time he missed that visitation and when, and a year after when he met the Lord, was he not still in ministry? He was still in ministry. The gift was still manifesting. The anointing was flowing. But he couldn't enter into the next phase. Why did God do that? Why did God not? Why didn't the Holy Spirit just say to him what? The Holy Spirit could have done that. But it took, the Holy Spirit, the Lord chose to do that by assigning the angel of his calling, the angel over his, the angel that sits over the scroll of his testimony. Now, the same thing happens today. There are lives, there are, you know, specific purposes and callings that men of God shouldn't carry. And there are specific angels. One of the things in recent that the Lord has, you know, spoken to me over and over again is, one of the ways to make a success of our callings, one of the ways to make us success of our callings in these end times with the, you know, kind of darkness that is coming is understanding in a very, you know, deep way, the ministry of angels. The understanding the church has had about angels in the past won't be sufficient today. If you start in previous years, the basic, the understanding the church had of angels is just, you know, speak the word, activate them. And, but now we've come to a point where it is necessary to be aware of their presence. It is necessary to see them. There's certain, of course, you do not have to talk to them every time, but there are various points in your walk with God where it will be necessary that you're able to see them and talk with them. There are some instances where they can speak what they are sent to say to you. They can speak it into your spiritual atmosphere, into your spiritual environment. And that what haven't been spoken over a period of time will filter into your spirit. But there are sometimes they need to be seen. They need to be, you need to be aware of them for what they have to say to be spoken. Otherwise, they won't say it until you see them. Okay. Now, two things. First, the activation of the glory of God, the anointing of God around us can, you know, heighten our spiritual senses to see. All right, into our immediate spiritual environment. So sometimes you can see angel, all right, without necessarily having to relate to them. Sometimes you can see angels, but it doesn't mean you have to interact. Now, one of the reasons is the activation of the unknowing thing, you know, your conscious of God's presence, you know, affect your senses. You will see things, you will hear things. You understand? But when it comes to interaction, that is where harnessing your spiritual senses comes in. For example, people have said things like, I can tell when an angel is around, but I don't see the angel. Now, the fact is that the responsibility of seeing them is yours. You have spiritual sense of sight. God will not use them for you. You need to be able to, you need to understand the place that will help you harness them.